I want to welcome you to the very first talk sponsored by the newly incepted Tang Center for Silk Road Studies. So this inaugural year, we are focusing on the maritime Silk Road, so I'm very happy that Osmund Bopearachchi will be our first speaker. Osmund, you know, gives me great pleasure to introduce him, both as a colleague and as a friend. Osmund is known to many of you. He's been affiliated with this campus for a number of years and is very well known to our faculty, students, and affiliates. Most of you are familiar with his impressive resume. If you are not, he has his own website, www.osmund-bopearachchi.com, which probably will take you an hour to go through. It's so extensive. Following his retirement as the Director of Research at the French National Center for Scientific Research and visiting professor at the University of Sorbonne in Paris, he signed up to come to Berkeley as an adjunct professor of Central and South Asian art, archaeology, and numismatics. He is the recipient of numerous awards, such as the Order of Constantine the Great, received during a grand ceremony in Athens, and my personal favorite, the honors of the Joint Staff of the Greek Army and the War Museum for the invaluable research and contribution to enhance the Greek civilization. He was most recently awarded the Georges Perrault Medal by the French Academy of Inscriptions and Belles Lettres for his collected oeuvre entitled From Bactria to Tabrobane, Selected Works of Osmund Bopearachchi. Other recent publications include an edited volume with Frank Holt, together with Frank Holt, entitled The Alexander Medallion, Exploring the Origins of a Unique Artifact, and 7 weeks after the Buddha's Enlightenment, Contradictions in Text, Confusion in Art. Now, my association with Osmund goes back several decades, and I will refrain from mentioning dates for reasons that will, I hope, for everybody be apparent. We first met at Musée Guimet in Paris, where I was conducting research for my MA on the ancient site of Bagram in Afghanistan, and Musée Guimet has the largest holding outside of Afghanistan. And Osmund was conducting research on the numismatic collection. So that's where we first met, and our interest in the art and archaeology of Central Asia, in particular trade and cultural exchange, was cultivated separately until the mid-1990s, when he invited me to join him on an excavation in Sri Lanka, which was focusing on the uncovering of ancient glassmaking and iron smelting sites along the riverine system on the southern part of the island. That work was part of a larger project entitled Seaborne and Inland Trade of Ancient Sri Lanka. Now, this interest in maritime trade resulted in a slew of articles over the last two decades, which you can find on his website, including several on the economic and artistic exchanges between Tamil Nadu and Sri Lanka. Now, our latest project, joint project, involved the underwater exploration of the Godavaya shipwreck off the southern coast of Sri Lanka. This is a ship that dates back to the turn of the Common Era, which was carrying raw materials destined perhaps for the aforementioned industrial sites connected through this riverine system. The data revealed by some of these projects that I just mentioned form the core of Osmund's lecture today, focusing in this case more specifically on the role of this type of maritime trade in the spread of Buddhism. Now, aside from his impressive professional resume, what else can I say about Osmund? He's a great cook. He's a lousy singer. He's a wonderful host for those who have the opportunity to visit Sri Lanka. I'm sorry, I'm putting you there, out there. A very fun-loving archaeological field director, as so many students who have worked on our projects could attest to. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Osmund Bopearachchi for this inaugural lecture. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Sanjot, for this wonderful introduction. It always gives me a pleasure when some when friends talk about me. So, as I told Sanjot, thank you very much for inviting me for the inaugural talk. As she has asked me, the talk will last for 58 minutes. So, reason why I say that I have written it down, I had this bad experience in the Asian Art Museum. I had about 300 slides to show within within 2 hours, and slides were just going.
Right. Oh.
So it has become customary to begin a talk on the maritime trade in the Indian Ocean, paying more attention to the Roman trade as if the Romans were the first to venture into the ocean. The Godavari shipwreck that Sanjot just spoke about it, dating to the second or the first centuries BCE, belonging to a period when Romans were still not engaged in the Indian Ocean trade. Dr. Sanjot Mehendale and I have discussed earlier in different forums at the UC Berkeley that the discovery of this shipwreck near the southern coast of Sri Lanka, 3 miles from the ancient seaport site of Godavaya, has revolutionized our knowledge of the history of the maritime trade in South Asia. The glass ingots, black and red ware, and grinding stones found in the shipwreck provide strong evidence for the close cultural links between Sri Lanka and South India. And it confirmed further the hypothesis put forward by us, according to which the boats leaving India sailed around the east coast of Sri Lanka so as to reach the dynamic port sites of the south and west. I shall develop today's talk, making Sri Lanka the center of the discussion for 3 reasons. Firstly, we have been working in Sri Lanka for the last 30 years, investigating the maritime and fluvial trade. Secondly, as witnessed by Cosmas Indopapalistus, the Egyptian monk of the 6th century CE, being situated in the center of the Indian Ocean, this island played a vital role in transmitting merchandise between East and West and North and South. Finally, the political, religious, and cultural history of Sri Lanka reflects the fluctuations of the markets, changing patterns of trading destinations, and evolution of Buddhist philosophies. The legendary Vijaya, the so-called founder of the Sinhalese race, should be understood as one of many North Indian traders who expanded their markets towards South India and beyond by invading the island of Lanka in circa 6th century BCE. The Thera Mahinda, son of Mauryan Emperor Ashoka, who converted the Sri Lankan king Devanampiyatisa to Buddhism, may have followed the same maritime route along the coast of India to reach the island. The ship carrying the sapling of the sacred Bodhi tree in Buddhgaya, along with Bhikshuni Sangamitta, followed the same route until Jambukolapattanam, and from there, the sprout of the tree was taken to Anuradhapura, capital of the island, following the inland trade route via Tantirimali. A few years later, 2 South Indian horse merchants were able to capture Suratissa, king of Anuradhapura, and ruled the country for 22 years. As multiple inscriptions dating back to the 3rd and 2nd centuries before the Common Era show, traders were sailing to Barbaricum at the estuary of the great Indus River and then to the land of Kambojas in Narakosia of the present-day Afghanistan and Pakistan in search of lapis lazuli, or sailing to Barukacha, the well-known port in Gujarat, looking for carnelians. though they never ventured beyond the north mouth of the Indus, the companions of Alexander the Great, like Nearchus, Onesicritus, and Aristobulus, transmitted to us several precious pieces of information that they received from the local informants, according to which Indians had a good knowledge of the island of Lanka and of its ships that arrived so far as Babericum. Several decades later, this knowledge was significantly enriched with Megasthenes, ambassador of Seleucus I, to the Indian court of Mauryas under Chandragupta, from whom we learn notably that Sri Lanka produced large beads that were exported to Indian continent. The export of precious stones from Sri Lanka to distant countries thus has a long history. The Greco-Bactrian rings found by chance not far from the ancient site of Icanum have a relationship in this context. According to the gemologist, the gold ring with a clear blue sapphire on a mount decorated with acanthus leaves, the gold ring with a clear, gold ring with a star ruby depicting stylized thunderbolt on the back came from Sri Lanka, and the diamonds set around the ruby most probably came from Golconda, the diamond mine in Andhra Pradesh in India. According to the recent study by Derek Content, the yellow sapphire found detached from its mount and carrying the legend Basileus Seleucu, means of the King Seleucus, found presumably in northern Afghanistan, also came from Sri Lanka. One may also add to this list a ruby detached from its ring, bearing a very symbolic monogram of the Indo-Greek coinage, and the intaglio engraved also with an Indo-Greek monogram, and a dolphin found in all probability in the proximity of Icanum. Let us add to this list two earrings also found in north of Afghanistan with garnets of very high quality decorated with symbolic dolphins of the Oxus River. The gold reliquary found accidentally, most probably in the vicinity of the ancient site of Begram in Afghanistan, containing 23 gold kushan and 2 Roman ori dated to the 1st and the 2nd century CE, is surmounted by a blue sapphire from Sri Lanka. Trade relations between Bactria and Taprobane are not without religious implications. The Pali Chronicle, the Mahavamsa, mentions Buddhists from Greek territories of Parapavisraye, that means Begram Kapisi area, among the foreign delegations who were invited by the Sinhalese king Dutugamanu in a close contemporary of the Indo-Greek Menander, who reigned around the middle of the 2nd century BCE, for the inauguration of the great stupa Ruwenvelisaya. Leaving aside the usual exaggerated figures often quoted in the Pali Chronicles, there is a historical truth behind this narration. Let me take another good example. The names of missionaries who were sent by Emperor Ashoka to the Himalayan region, Himavat, like Majjhima, Sashanama, Mulikadeva, Dubisara, and Kashyapagota, mentioned only in the Pali Chronicles, are now attested by epigraphical evidence. Kashyapagota from the Sanchi Stupa number 2, and Majjhima and Dubisara from recently excavated Kanaganali Stupa, not only precious commodities, but also valuable information circulated along with them. So, the discovery of carnelian beads and lapis lazuli in archaeological context in South India and Sri Lanka, and rubies, garnets, blue and yellow sapphires in Afghanistan are proofs of the north-south and south-north orientations of trade activities. While the north-south expansions were going on, east-west relations were being established by pious Buddhist donors. For example, four columns adorning the Ayaka were gifted to the Kanaganali stupa by a Gahapati, translated by Foninuba as a banker, Asila from Dhanyakataka, the capital of the Satavahana kingdom, situated at least 300 miles to the east of Kanaganali stupa. Likewise, a Pushpagani, a flower altar, was gifted by the wife of a well-to-do man, Naga, also from Dhanyakataka. These are only few examples to show how the merchants traveling across the country and making pious donations to build religious monuments. Another bad habit of many who dealt with the Indian Ocean trade is to consider the maritime routes alone, leaving aside the fluvial and land routes, which were also closely connected with the regional infrastructure. Our own investigations at the estuaries and along the rivers in South India and Sri Lanka have brought to light enough evidence to indicate that in ancient times, large ships were anchored in the sea close to the river mouths, and trade commodities were taken to inland markets using the rivers and waterfronts. The estuaries of the big rivers, designated as seaports, with the suffix Pattinam, Titta, Totta in Tamil and Sinhalese, never had man-made dugout harbors like the ones attested in the Greek and Roman world. The location of emporia along the rivers must have facilitated the transactions with the interior regions. The fluvial transportation in the ancient world was less dangerous than and less expensive than the land routes. Palladius, the Latin author of the 5th century CE, says that there are five navigable rivers in Sri Lanka. As early as the end of the 1st century CE, Pliny the Elder speaks of the role of these rivers in relation to particular trading procedure. I quote, "Merchandise is placed on the further bank of a river alongside what they have to sell, and they take home if they are pleased with the barter." Quotation ends. English historian H.W. Cave in 1908 has described how, until the construction of the railway system, and even at the beginning of the 20th century, sailing crafts carried chests of low-grown tree 60 miles down the Kalyani River to the sea, and thence to the harbor and to the warehouse in Colombo. This method was less expensive than the bullock carts, which demanded more manpower. It is important to underline here, almost all the important Buddhist sites in India, Sri Lanka, Burma, and Thailand are inland and clustered around the big rivers flowing to the Indian Ocean. All the Gandharan Buddhist sites were built around the Upper Indus River and its tributaries, the Kabul and Swat rivers. Vast Buddhist complexes of North India, like Mathura, Vaishali, Sarnath, Nalanda, and Bodh Gaya, are situated either in the vicinity of the Ganges or of its tributaries, like Yamuna and Niranjana rivers. Buddhist sites of the Satavahana and Ishvaku periods, like Amaravati, Nagarjunakonda, Granthashala, Jagapita in Andhra Pradesh, are located along the Krishna River. Likewise, ancient capitals and Buddhist complexes of Sri Lanka were inland, but each had one port on the coast. Mantai, the most active port in ancient Sri Lanka, was located close to Malvatuya, which linked the port to the inland capital of Anuradhapura. The location of the ancient capital of Polonnaruwa on the banks of the Mahaveli River, which flows to the sea at Gokarna, is no coincidence. Similarly, Tissamarama, Sri Lanka's ancient city in the south, flourished thanks to its location on the left bank of the Kirindoya, which connected to the town to the ancient port of Kirinda. nearly 3,000 stupas and monasteries were built in Bagan at the right bank of the Irrawaddy River in Burma. This photograph was taken with Bo when we took the balloon. Right. Dwaravati, Sukhothai, and Ayutthaya complexes were established along the Chao Phraya River in Thailand. Only the widespread and gigantic Buddha cave complexes of the Deccan Plateau in Maharashtra are an exception, because the traders who sponsored these sumptuous dwellings of the Buddhist monks followed the land trade routes. The Western Ghats, being too close to the shore, there aren't major rivers fall into the Arabian Sea. Instead, they flow eastward. Among them, Godavari and the Krishna River hold an important place. These traders used the Nanigat Pass in the Western Ghats range near the Junar in Pune district to reach the interior regions. This photograph was taken only last year. They still take the same route at Nanigat. Literally, the name Nane means coin and the Ghat means pass. So name is given because this path was used as a toll booth to collect toll from the traders crossing the hills. Having made these factors clear, namely the existence of a free Roman regional maritime network and the importance of the inland fluvial and land route connected with the seaports at the estuaries, we can now discuss briefly the Roman trade. Mariners from Egypt invested in mass-scale trading activities in the Indian Ocean, where Asian mariners had already mastered the navigation routes. Roman ships left Egypt in July to reach the Gulf of Aden, and from there, utilizing the southwest monsoon, sailed to the ports of Barigaza, Broach in Gujarat, Mussoorie in Kerala, on the west coast of India. Pliny the Elder's natural history provides information on the precise on the prices of foreign goods in first century CE, and pepper, later came to be known as black gold, was one of the most costly commodities among them. An Indian storage jar discovered in a courtyard north of the Serapis Temple at the Red Sea port site of Berenike, dated to the first century CE, contained 7.5 kilograms of black pepper, a vital piece of evidence demonstrating the dynamics of Roman trade with India. It is this trade that is echoed in the Sangam text, where the splendid ships of the Yavana, referring to the Romans, bring gold and return with pepper, be it in the form of the Periyar. Periyar is the river. Pattinam on the Periyar Delta in the north of Cochin, discovered and excavated by P.J. Cherian and his colleagues from the Kerala Council for Historical Research, was undoubtedly an important emporium. The site yielded amphorae types found throughout the Mediterranean Sea and the Indian Ocean, and the wide range of provenance of the amphorae includes particularly southern Italy and Gaul, France. The recent book by Ingo Strau, Deciphering and Interpreting the Inscriptions Left by the Sailors and Merchants Inside the Cave Named Hok in the island of Socotra, is remarkable contribution to the studies of maritime trade in the Indian Ocean. Socotra, the main island of an archipelago located in the Arabian Sea, at the entrance of the Red Sea, certainly played a decisive role in the long distance commercial activities between the Greco-Roman and Indian worlds. The corpus composed of 119 epigraphic documents written by 117 scribes, both Indian and non-Indian, South Arabic, Aksumites, Palmyrenian, Greek and Bactrian. The dating of the inscriptions by the paleography is between the 2nd and the 4th century CE. This area corresponded to a period of great intensity of navigation in the Arabian Sea. Among the seafarers who left their signatures, Vishnudhara, Sihar, and Shura Ganja are mentioned as the inhabitants of the famous port site of Barukacha. It is also said that a Buddhist Scythian monk named as Sakashramana also visited this cave. Another important evidence for direct Roman trade with India at the close of the first century CE was the discovery of thousands of Roman oeri and denarii on Indian soil, the majority attributed to the Julio-Claudian period. Compared to thousands of early imperial coins found in India, very few of the early Roman types were discovered in Sri Lanka. Why did the Romans, who had commercial relations with India, not enter into direct trading partnership with Sri Lanka during the first three centuries of our era? Strabo notes that the Taprobane ivory, tortoiseshell, and other merchandise were brought in abundance to the markets of India. It may be that there was no need for Romans to go all the way to Sri Lanka as long as its products could be obtained easily and abundantly at the Indian ports. It was during first three centuries of the Common Era that the South Indian traders played an intermediary role between Alexandrian traders and Sri Lankans, and it was during this period they came from Andhra and Tamil Nadu to Sri Lanka in search of merchandise. These traders, when visiting religious monuments, would have brought votive plaques as offerings to Buddha, Buddhist establishment on the island. This is the reason why some steles in Andhra style depicting scenes from Buddha's lives were found in religious monuments of Sri Lanka. Many art historians believe that the worship of image in early Buddhism in Sri Lanka would have been contradictory to the Theravada philosophy of the renunciation of all sensual experiences. Therefore, the cult of the Buddha image developed in the island under the Mahayana patronage of Abhayagiriwasi. Compared to Sanchi, Bharut, Amaravati, Mathura, and Gandhara, Buddhist schools, ancient Sri Lanka is almost deprived of narrative scenes, meaning reliefs, rock cut images depicting the life of the historical Buddha or his previous life's Jataka stories. In spite of this, some portable marble reliefs from Amaravati and Nagarjunakonda style depicting various Buddhist themes were found in the island, and their number increases day by day with new discoveries. The great stupas of Amaravati, Kanaganhalli, Nagarjunakonda, and many others in the Krishna Valley symbolize, like many Buddhist monuments in North India, such as Sanchi and Bharut, the political and economic supremacy of the ruling dynasty. However, there was an indisputable religious motivation from the local Buddhist population for the construction of these Buddhist monuments in the Krishna Valley. Resources needed to build these monuments would have come from the devout mercantile classes of Buddhists who were well established in Dahanekataka, the capital of the Satavahanas. The great quantities of foreign glassware, pottery of Western types, Mediterranean amphorae used as wine and olive containers, and Roman gold coins representing bullion trade uncovered in the distribution centers along the Krishna River demonstrate the flourishing domestic and international trade. Apart from the commercial interactions, the cultural and religious relations between Andhra Desha and Sri Lanka drew the Buddhist communities closer. So much so, a branch of Mahavihara from Anuradhapura was established in Sihala Vihara in Nagarjunakonda. Another Buddhist sect from Sri Lanka was at Chula Dharmagiri Vihara. an inscription dated to 1344, engraved during the reign of Bonekabau IV at Gadaladeniya Kandy district, refers to some repairs carried out in the two-storied image shrine at Tahannekataka, showing long-standing cultural relationships between Andhra and Sri Lanka. The imported sculptures from so far attested on the island can be divided into three large chronological groups. Sculptures executed during the second phase of the high period of Amaravati, close to the downfall of the Satavahana dynasty at the beginning of the 3rd century CE. The following sculptures belong to the first chronological group. The sculptures found from the Bodhigara, popularly known as Kurunagala Road Shrine in Anuradhapura, depicting the dream of Maya and the interpretation of the dream. 12 sculptures from the Bodhigara, popularly known as Asanagara of the Abhegiribhasa, mainly fragmented. The special attention should be given to the Erotos figure, winged figure. And the relief depicting the presentation of Prince Rahula to the Buddha by Yashodhara, now in Tissamaharama Rajamahavihara. Sculptures belonging to the Ishwaku period in Nagarjunakonda, late 3rd and early 4th century CE, may belong to the second chronological period, like sculptures found in the Bodhigara at Jetavanarama. The following reliefs belong to the third chronological group, meaning the post-Ishwaku period, late 4th, 5th century CE, Kantaka bidding farewell to Prince Siddhartha from the Girihandu Vihara, the universal monarch, Chakravartin, found 6 months back in the irrigation canal at Tissamaharama, now in the Department of Archaeology, Buddhas of the past, Bodhisattvas, and Buddha performing the dual miracle at Sravasti from Pidurangala Stupa, and above all, the relief from Kumukwava depicting the Buddha's enlightenment and 7 weeks he spent in the vicinity of the Bodhimanda. The vast majority of these reliefs were found in Bodhi shrines known as Bodhigara. The plaques unearthed from the three Bodhigaras, the Kurunagala Road Shrine, the Abhegiri Vihara, and the Jetavanarama Vihara, were found in a clear archaeological context. Although one cannot be certain, the relief depicting a Chakravartin from Tissamaharama may have come from the Bodhigara at the Sandagiri Dagaba complex. There seems to have been a ritual of offering plaques by traders to the Bodhigaras in early Anuradhapura period. Senra Parnavitana was the first to demonstrate firmly that, like the panels depicting the scenes from the life of Sakyamuni, the first images of the Buddhas were also imported from Andhra. A few such stone Buddha images imported from Andhra are known. The Buddha statue found in December 2001, not far from the Sandagiri Dagaba in Tissamaharama, published by us, has all the characteristics of the late Amaravati tradition. The stylistic features of these sculptures, such as the diaphanous samgati, overrobe, in regular schematic folds in relief, leaving the right shoulder bare, and the right hand held in forward in the Abhyamudra, and the left holding the uplifted hem of the robes, inspired all the standing images of the Blessed One until today. There are some sculptures in Sri Lanka directly inspired by the Andhra prototypes. They are limited to few sculptures from Abhegiri and Jetavanarama stupas depicting some scenes from the life of the Buddha, such as the Brahma pleading with Blessed One to reconsider his decision not to preach. The exhortation of the gods to the Bodhisattva to descend from the Tushita heaven, and the Sarvam Dada Jataka that you see here. All the early iconographies of Sri Lankan art, very highly inspired by the Andhra prototypes, such as Chakravartin, that's the Dataka story, Chakravartin, the universal monarch, Kubera, the lord of wealth, Sankanidhi and Padmanidhi. Of course, today they are venerated like gods. Sumorphic Nagas and anthropomorphic Nagarajas and Naginis and Purnagata. A new era opened up in the relations between Rome and Sri Lanka during the reign of Emperor Claudius, following the accidental visit to the island of Annius Plocamus, a collector of taxes in the Red Sea. It appears that it was following this visit that a delegation was sent from Sri Lanka to Romanuka, to Rome. It is striking to note that recent research carried out by our Italian colleagues on the mummy of Grotta Rossa of an 8-year-old girl found 11 kilometers from Via Cassia in north of Rome testifies to the trade between Rome and Sri Lanka. The child's body, placed in a sarcophagus decorated with the hunting scenes, inspired by an episode of the Book 4 of the Aeneid, is currently preserved in the National Museum of Palazzo Massimo in Rome. Near the mummy was an ivory doll with articulated arms and legs, gold earrings, a gold ring decorated with a winged victory, small red amber vases, and small amulets. The mummy wore fine tunic of Chinese silk, a gold necklace adorned with 13 blue sapphires. Italian archaeologists and gemologists, having worked for 2 years, came to the conclusion that the blue sapphires came from Sri Lanka. The decorations of the sarcophagus and the analysis of the offerings led the archaeologists to date the tomb to the second half of the second century CE. It is only in this context that we can explain the Roman motifs sculpted on the stamba on either side of the eastern Vahalkada of the Abhigiri Dagaba, depicting a Kalpavruksha, the tree of life, in the form of a candelabrum, that is the candle tree, with a stem issuing from the Purnagata decorated with family animals like elephants and humbulls, as well as winged cupid. So if you look at from the paintings from Pompeii, you can see the parallels, and also the griffins. And these are some paintings, again, from Pompeii and from some Roman pictures. So cupids, griffins, and foliage at each branch of the candelabrum, imitating the undulating acanthus leaves, are all borrowed from the Greek and Roman art. We know for sure the sculptures of the four Vahalkadas, the four frontispieces of the Abhigiri Dagaba, should be dated to the second century CE, thanks to the slab inscription at the South Vahalkada. It enables us to firmly date the four Vahalkadas to the reign of Kantakathisa of the second century. The iconography of the Kalpavruksha in the form of a candelabrum at the eastern Vahalkada of the Abhigiri Dagaba has served as the prototype for many pillars of the ancient Dagabas like Kantaka Chaitya, Jetonarama Dagaba, and Dakkinatupa. In all these pillars, the original iconography was misinterpreted. The acanthus leaves lost their indented form and became stylized. Griffins kept their beak but lost their wings. And in some sculptures, they were converted to simple lions. The cupids as well lost their wings, lost in translation. Sometimes they hold their hand in Anjali Mudra, sometimes they make funny gestures with no relationship with the original prototype. The original Roman motifs have lost their identity, leaving space to the imagination of the local sculptors. the Roman inspiration on Andhra art is amply discussed by Shivaramamurthy and recently Rosenstone, comparing Roman iconographies of the monterey types and reliefs with some significant scenes or motifs depicted in Andhra art. René Grouzet, the well-known French orientalist, described the head of the Buddha from Krishna Valley, now in the Paris Museum, as virtually, quote, statue portrait of ancient Rome, closed. He further argued the Romano-Alexandrine influence can be detected in the production of the Amaravati school and is clearly expressed in this sculpture with its definite realism and expressivity. As I have already mentioned earlier, such inspirations can be explained by the historically attested maritime contacts and trading relationships between east coast of India and the Mediterranean basin during the first two centuries of our era. There is no doubt that the description of Taprobane by Ptolemy marks the moment of the greatest extension of Greco-Roman knowledge of Sri Lanka. However, the great abundance of Roman third brass and their imitations in Sri Lanka may be a result of the revival of the Western powers through Aksumites, Himyarites, and Persian middlemen, which coincides with the foundation of Constantinople as the seat of the Roman Empire, on the one hand, and on the other hand, with the gradual shift of the focus of trade from South Indian coasts to Sri Lanka. The eastward expansion of the maritime trade connection, Sri Lanka with Southeast Asia, played an important role in the growth of Buddhist thought and art. The earliest Sri Lankan contacts with Thailand, as revealed by iconographic similarities, goes back to the time of Mon Kingdom of Dwaravati, which may existed as early as the 5th century CE. Charlotte Galloway, in a recent article, explores the artistic relationship between Pu and Mo of Burma and Dwaravati Mo of Thailand in the light of contemporary research. Her further research on Pu terracotta figurines may enlighten us more on the Pu and Sri Lankan contacts. The close links between Sri Lanka and Burma certainly pave way to the iconographies based on Pali literature. The Pali canon became the basis of the Buddhist in Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia, and the Pali may have served as lingua franca for the communication between Sri Lanka and Burma. The Buddhavamsa, a part of the Kudukka Nikaya, which in turn is a part of the Sutta Pitaka, was also very popular in Burma. The text of the Buddhavamsa is written out in Burmese characters on the walls of the Thambula temple in Bagan, which is approximately dated to the 13th century. The political affiliation between Sri Lanka and Burma reached its apogee when Vijayabahu in the 11th century, then fighting against the Chola, received the help from the King of Myanmar. The decline of Buddhism caused by the Chola occupation of Sri Lanka promoted King Vijayabahu to invite monks from Ramanya, Myanmar, this is the Nikaya which is even today called as Ramanya, to purify the Sangha of the three Nikayas. From the 7th century onwards, the Chinese, Arab, Persian, and South Indian merchants developed their trade with Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia. It was with the sudden burst of trade activities between China, the Middle East in the 7th century, Sri Lanka began to play a decisive role in the maritime trade between East and West. It was during this peak of this movement between East and West that Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara and his consort Tara became popular as the protector of sailors in whole of Asia. I shall make use of this opportunity to summarize the preliminary results obtained from the Avalokiteshvara survey project launched by the Center for Buddhist Studies, UC Berkeley, and the National Center for Scientific Research, CNRS, with École Normale Supérieure, Paris, in collaboration with the Department of Archaeology in Sri Lanka. Using GIS mapping software to uncover spatial and temporal patterns, this project's aim was to investigate the relationship between Buddhism and maritime trade in Sri Lanka and beyond. I present these results on behalf of my colleagues who are the main collaborators of this project. When the true cult of Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara as the patron of mariners confronted by the inevitable perils of distant voyages began to gain popularity in Sri Lanka in the 7th century onwards, his images were erected in sanctuaries built at the mouths of the rivers or bays facing the sea or inland along the navigable rivers. Among many inscriptions underscoring the closer relationship between the mercantile communities and Buddhism is a Sanskrit inscription from Thiriyai in Sri Lanka, which refers to the companies of merchants who endowed a Mahayana Buddhist shrine dedicated to the Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara and his consort Tara. The relationship Avalokiteshvara and the mercantile community particular is an interesting one. The reputation of Avalokiteshvara offering protection to seafaring traders gained much popularity in South Asian art, especially in Buddhist cave sculptures and paintings of the Western Deccan. The depiction in ancient Indian art of the Ashtamaha Abhaya, Avalokiteshvara, in which the Bodhisattva protecting human beings from the eight great perils are common in Maharashtra. Among them, the representation of the, representations of the eight dangers, his role as a savior of shipwrecked mariners is given a prominent place. However, it is important to underline here, since the land routes were more perilous, 7 out of 8 are related to the perils encountered by the traders who took the land routes. Let me briefly discuss the results obtained from the our survey project. 3 types of sculptures of Avalokiteshvara were recorded during our survey: bronze statues, rock cut images, stone statues in the round. Most of the bronze statues were locally cast, but some were imported by traders and pious monks. 11 Bodhisattvas, 3 of Taras, and 4 of Dhani Buddhas were found buried under a paving stone of a ruined meditation hall in April 1983 by the Department of Archaeology at Thiriyaya. Among them, 2 bronze statues of standing Avalokiteshvara, 2 bronze statues of Avalokiteshvara seated in Raja Leelasana, and 2 solid cast bronze statues of Tara standing in Tribhanga, and a beautiful statue of Adibuddha or Vajradharma with elaborately worked Jatamakuta depicting the 5 Tathagatas or Dhani Buddhas were discovered on the same day. The solid cast bronze image of the Buddha seated in Vajrasana displaying the Bhumisparsha Mudra, touching the earth, of the Pala style, and the statue of Padmapani Avalokiteshvara seated in Lalitasana displaying the Varada Mudra were certainly imported from northeast India, most probably from Bihar. The fact that the Thiriyaya's location on the bank of the Yanoya, one of the main openings to the sea routes of the east, suggests that it may have accumulated souvenirs of mariners and merchants who were frequent visitors of the Buddhist shrine. The gold-plated Tara image in Tribhanga, now in the British Museum, was probably found in the east coast of Sri Lanka to the south of Trincomalee. Perhaps the most beautiful Avalokiteshvara image ever found in the island was from Veheragala near Anuradhapura. The statue of Avalokiteshvara dressed both in ascetic attire and princely garments was found in the Malvatu River by a fisherman, it came to his net, in the middle of the ancient city of Anuradhapura. The most interesting characteristic of this statue is the presence of the animal hide and the dhoti and the presence of a frontal animal face on the right thigh. Statues of Tara and Avalokiteshvara were found in 2002 during an archaeological excavation conducted in the Padanagara, the meditation house, situated between Ruanweli Mahasaya and Baswakulima Tank in Anuradhapura. Like in Tiriyaya, these statues, hidden with 55 Buddha images, all made of bronze. It also noteworthy that they were found in the Mahavihara premises, known as the seat of the Theravada Buddhism in the island. The finding of so many Mahayana statues in Padanagaras, scattered all over the island, may suggest that these images were used for tantric Abhisheka ceremonies. The discovery of Abhisheka Mandapa, not only at the south gate of the Abhigiri Vihara, the seat of Mahayana, but also two Abhisheka Mandapas in the Mahavihara is significant. Among the statues imported to Sri Lanka, the bronze statue of four-headed Lokeshwara holding a Padma, Kamandalu, Akshamala, and Pustaka from Khmer, dated to the 9th century, found in Devundara, the famous seaport at the most southern tip of the island, shows the maritime contacts of Sri Lanka with Cambodia and the importance of Avalokiteshvara cult. All the rock-cut images of Mahayana Bodhisattvas were found either close to the seaports or along the fluvial land routes. The rock-carved unfinished Bodhisattva images from Tantirimale are situated on the ancient land route connecting Anuradhapura with the ancient port of Jambukolapatnam that I mentioned earlier. The well-preserved image of Singhanada Lokeshwara, carved in high sunk relief at Kusharajagala, near the ancient seaport of Mahavalukagama, Veligama, at the estuary of Polluvathuganga, is a good such example. The rock-cut carvings of the Buddha Pattuna, of the Buddha flanked by two Avalokiteshvara images, one ascetic, the other of the princely type, are situated near the Villoya, Will River, which flows to the ocean at the east coast. By the 7th century, the erection of freestanding Avalokiteshvara images at the estuaries and along the fluvial and land trade routes became very popular. Mahayana statues of this period were more numerous than the Buddha images. Two main types of stone images of standing Avalokiteshvara are attested in Sri Lanka. The first is the yogi or ascetic type, and the second is the princely or the bejeweled type. Latter wears royal garments like highly complicated earrings, several necklaces, armlets, and anklets. The yogi Avalokiteshvara is essentially an ascetic figure that can be distinguished by the ajina, the height of an animal, such as an antelope or tiger, tied around the waist to hold the dhoti. The high crown on his head complements a slightly elongated face. Two braids of hair fall across the shoulders. The present survey also enabled us to discover hitherto unknown inscriptions, images, votive tablets, denoting both Mahayana and Vajrayana concepts. The most important discovery in this regard is an inscription of Vajradhatu Mandala, studied at length by Kelly Powell, of the Department of South and Southeast Asian Studies of US Berkeley, witnessing the presence and practice of Tantric Mahayana or Vajrayana in the Sri Lankan capital of Anuradhapura in the 8th centuries. Though the study of Sri Lankan Mahayana and Vajrayana is in its infancy, all evidence thus far uncovered points to a centrality of Sarva Tathagata Sattva Samgraha and its Vajradhatu Mandala system to Abhigiri Vihara and its association to forest viharas. The inscription was discovered on November the 10th, 2010, during the conservation of the southwest portion of the dome of the Abhigiri stupa. It was found in a niche made specially for the purpose of housing it at an elevation of 125 feet, a depth of 11 feet, and 90 feet south of the West Ayaka towards the South Ayaka. The Abhigiri Stupa inscription is just one such piece of evidence. I am most grateful to Kelly Powell for authorizing me to present this very important document, and sincerely hope that she will publish it soon. The Vajrabodhi's visit to Abhigiri Vihara was meant to collect as many as Mahayana texts as possible. According to the biography of the great Tang court monk Vajrabodhi, written by his lay disciple Lucian, probably compiled within 2 decades of Vajrabodhi's death, Vajrabodhi was instructed by Avalokiteshvara, who appeared in front of him in these words, I quote, "Your studies have now been completed. Go to Singhala, Sri Lanka, to pay homage to the Buddha's tooth and climb Mountain Lanka to worship the Buddha's footprint. Upon your return, go to the Middle Kingdom and pay your respect to the Bodhisattva Manjushri. That country has a karmic connection with you. You should go to spread the teachings and save all beings." End of quotation. Following his advice, he went to Sri Lanka and stayed in Abhaya Raja Monastery, which is the Abhigiri Vihara, and made obeisance to the Buddha's tooth and climbed the mountain Lanka, the Sripada, and venerated Buddha's footprint. 1 year after his arrival in Sri Lanka, Vajrabodhi returned to the kingdom in South India. After a month passed, he revealed to the king his intention to visit land of China, pay his respect to Manjushri, and spread Buddhist Dharma. In spite of the warnings of the South Indian king, who insisted upon the dangers of the route, Vajrabodhi decided to go to China, as he has been instructed by Avalokiteshvara. The king then requests the holy monk to present the Tang king the Sanskrit copy of Mahaprajnaparamita Sutra and the chair adorned with 7 precious materials, a gold bracelet adorned with 7 precious materials, earrings inlaid with jewels, miscellaneous articles, armor, silk, cords, Borneo camphor, various goods and aromatics. Vajrabodhi, facing east, paid homage to Manjushri from afar and paid homage to Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara in the west. Catching a favorable wind, they crossed the sea in a day and a night and arrived at the port of Bosili in Sri Lanka, which is, I'm certain, is Beruala. They encountered 35 Persian vessels which were trading in precious stones in that country, and Vajrabodhi was accepted. After a month, they reached the kingdom of Vijaya, meaning Sri Vijaya, an important center for the expansion of Buddhism from the 8th to the 12th centuries. Hampered by foul winds, they stayed there for 5 months. It was only after the winds had settled that they were able to set out again. When they were within 20 days from the Tang territory, all of a sudden, they encountered foul winds, which suddenly gave rise to fog, which they were in the middle of the ocean, when they were in the middle of the ocean. The 30-odd Persian merchant vessels drifted with the waves, and it is not known what happened to them. Only the single ship carrying Vajrabodhi was able to escape this disaster. For about 3 years, they passed through the foreign lands, experiencing various hardships, and only then did they manage to reach the imperial borders of the Great Tang. This interesting episode, which took place in the 8th century CE, reveals a great deal of information on the seafaring in the Indian Ocean, diffusion of Buddhist thought, and commodities exchange in trade. The maritime route that Persian ships took with Vajrabodhi on board was the same as that frequented by Sinhalese bhikkhunis nuns on their way to southern China. Chinese sources record during the period from the last year of the Zhou to the end of the Tang, 11 Sinhalese embassies to China. The first real Sinhalese embassy was the one that arrived in 405 that had left the island in circa 395, and it was headed by a monk, Dharma Yukta. During the reign of Mahanama, four embassies arrived in China in 428. It is evident that during this period, the institutional relations between China and Sri Lanka were particularly intense, probably stimulated by Fasian's stay on the island. To these diplomatic relations, one must in fact add religious ties generated by the well-known journeys of the Singh. To conclude today's long voyage in the Indian Ocean in search of the expansion of Buddhist thought and art, let me refer to a story narrated in the ancient Buddhist texts found among the recently discovered Gandhari scrolls from Afghanistan, now in the British Library. It clearly says that Buddha, in a previous life, was a merchant of the great ocean who set out to sea with the supplies he had collected. As we have attempted to show, the spread of Buddhism from Southeast Asia to Southeast Asia is closely connected with the growth of the maritime networks based on trade and facilitate the movement of the Buddhist merchants, traveling monks, and teachers. The seafaring traders and caravan merchants were no doubt interested in the exchange of commodities to make profits, but they were also, as revealed by epigraphic and literary evidence, the earliest donors and important patrons of Buddhist establishment in South and Southeast Asia. The resources needed to build gigantic religious monuments would thus have come from both royal patronage as well as the devout mercantile classes. Their wealth was based on the flourishing inland and international trade centers located in the ports along the coast and navigable rivers. As Buddhism, the basic concepts of Buddhist art were also introduced to Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia from India. Although artists from these respective countries drew much inspiration from the Buddhist centers of India, very particularly from Andhra Tamil Nadu, the artistic expressions developed in a cross-fertilized context, ingeniously incorporating the sentiments and aesthetics of their respective populations. Instead of reproducing stereotypical prototypes, they created new forms of art. Finally, I also wish to emphasize that our preliminary investigation on the spatial distribution of the Avalokiteshvara statues in Sri Lanka as a whole show the importance of the role played by the Bodhisattva as the protector of mariners. Although Pali chronicles, very particularly the Mahavamsa, does not make any reference to doctrinal or institutional manifestations of Mahayana, the archaeological and epigraphical evidence show very clearly that Mahayana Buddhism played a significant role in the history of the island. The time has come for the Buddhist scholars, archaeologists, epigraphists, and art historians to examine closely the diffusion of Vajrayana Buddhism from India to Sri Lanka and then to Southeast Asia and China, paying more attention to archaeological, epigraphic, textual, and iconographic evidence. I thank you very much.